On behalf of the Open Society Foundations, good evening and welcome to tonight's panel, National Security, Secrecy, and Surveillance, Defending the Public's Right to Know. My name is Nancy Chang, and I have had the pleasure of directing the Open Society Foundation's National Security and Human Rights Campaign since its launch in January of 2008. I'll be stepping down from my position at the end of this week, so it's an extra special privilege for me to host this forum. The five individuals on this podium have worked courageously and tirelessly to expose misguided and myopic decisions made behind closed doors in the post 9/11 decade in the name of national security. They are driven by their conviction that the American public should participate in the national security decisions that will determine our nation's role in the world, and that our long-term safety depends on adherence to the democratic principles in our Constitution and the human rights treaties to which we are a party. I am reserving to our moderator, Steve Aftergood, the privilege of introducing our four panelists. They are Jamil Jaffer, Tim Shorrock, Jesselyn Raddick, and Tom Drake. But I have reserved to myself the privilege of introducing Steve Aftergood. Steve has directed the Project on Government Secrecy at the Federation of American Scientists for 19 years. And he is the publisher of the highly renowned and closely watched in government and other quarters Secrecy News newsletter. Steve's name comes up all the time. He has a record of releasing very important national security documents, shedding light on their significance and their historical context. He is working behind the scenes all the time to educate journalists, investigators, and others, human rights advocates, about the world of secrecy, classification and declassification reforms that are needed, and how to obtain documents and put them into the public light. He is constantly being thanked by so many leading investigative journalists of our time for his wisdom and expertise. So before turning this event over to Steve, I just want to let you all know that this event is being audio and video recorded and that the recordings of our discussion will be posted online. At the Q&A session, if you have a question, please raise your hand and someone will be there to hand you a microphone. So please join me in welcoming Steve and all of our panelists.
Thank you, Nancy, and thank you to the Open Society Foundations. Many of us have had a troubling feeling that the landscape, the political landscape, the national security landscape has shifted under our feet since 9/11. Things that we never thought we'd hear about in our political culture, things like torture, warrantless surveillance, detention without trial, all of these things suddenly became realities in our lives. While executive authority has been concentrated and a blanket of secrecy seemed to cover the entire national security apparatus. This evening, I hope we will deepen our understanding of those perceptions, if indeed those perceptions are correct, and see if we can shed any light on directions forward. Where do we go from here? To help us answer those questions, we have a really amazing collection, an amazing group of people. I can say that because I know them and I have admired their work for quite some time. Each of them in a different way has devoted not just years, but also their hearts and souls to confronting the challenge of the national security apparatus, the problem of surveillance, the possibility of democracy under current conditions. I want to give them just the very briefest of introductions because their presence here with you tonight means more at this moment than does their bios. But you should have just at least a basic sense of who they are if you don't already know. Tom Drake, to my right, is a former military, former Air Force officer, former official of the National Security Agency, best known, not always happily for him, as a whistleblower who exposed what he regarded as abuse, waste, misconduct at the National Security Agency, and paid for it with a bone-wrenching prosecution from which he emerged at the end victorious. I want to ask him a little bit about that in a couple of minutes. Just a few more words about our other panelist. Jesselyn Radak is the foremost champion of Thomas Drake, and one of the reasons, I think, why he is not in jail at this very moment. Jesselyn is herself a whistleblower, a former Justice Department official. She wrote a really amazing book, which I read on the train this afternoon from DC, called Traitor, the Whistleblower and the American Taliban, on her story as a whistleblower. I can tell you it is eye-opening and infuriating and beautifully written, and I would recommend it to all of you. I'm going to ask her some questions about the challenges facing whistleblowers and what is needed to protect them and help them to thrive. Tim Shorrock, to Jesselyn's right, is an investigative journalist and author who has specialized in mapping the terrain of the national security bureaucracy, and especially its component that is made up of national security contractors, that is, private enterprises that work for government agencies. He's the author of Spies for Hire, which is a groundbreaking book on that subject. Jamil Jaffer is an attorney with the ACLU who has been literally at the cutting edge of the entire spectrum of national security controversies in the post 9/11 era, from torture to detention to surveillance and on. He's the co-author of a book, Administration of Torture, and a leading figure in the efforts to confront national security secrecy through litigation. Let me start with Tom Drake and just ask you to reflect, if you would, on your experience for a few minutes. And maybe the way to start doing that is to ask what you would say to an NSA employee today who is thinking about becoming a whistleblower, who is thinking about challenging what appears to be an abuse of executive authority in that agency?
A simple response is, you better lawyer up.
Better lawyer up.
Better lawyer up.
What happens if you don't?
Well, even if you do, but you're even more exposed if you don't. But even if you do, you're liable to be criminally prosecuted for having exposed and disclosed criminal wrongdoing by the government.
And why is that? I mean, aren't there whistleblower protection laws in place? Don't government officials say they want people to bring waste and abuse to their attention?
They say that, but in this post 9/11 security world, has not certainly been the track record.
Mm-hmm.
If anything, whistleblowers are severely retaliated against. They are essentially excommunicated from their natural allies. They're pushed out of their institutions or set aside internally through a death by a thousand bureaucratic cuts.
Now, Honestly, I'm not thrilled with the term whistleblower because to me it seems somewhat loaded. It's basically saying, you know, I am righteous and the people I'm against are corrupt, which may be true, but when people call themselves whistleblowers, you know, one wonders, is it self-serving or not? In Tom Drake's case, he is sort of the paradigmatic true whistleblower who went through every step that a government employee is supposed to go through in order to both comply with the rules and to expose wrongdoing. Could you itemize for us what are some of those steps, and did any of them work? Did any of them work the way they are supposedly supposed to?
None of them did in my case. The great paradox here is that you would think by exercising the internal channels that are reasonably well defined within government, even within the intelligence community, even under the Intelligence Community Whistleblower Protection Act, that would afford you some protection. By virtue of having exercised the internal channels, I was actually exposed by the very institutions that I was reporting on, even internally. Mm. So I went to my immediate superior, who was a number three person at the time at NSA. I also went to the Office of the Inspector General within NSA, to other senior officials at NSA, including the Office of General Counsel. I had made contact with both the House and Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, and I was also part of a hotline complaint that was submitted to the Department of Defense Inspector General. In all cases, nothing happened.
And I know that in the case of the House Intelligence Committee, you had at least one ally in the form of a committee staffer named Diane Rourke, who, if I understand correctly, participated with you in pursuing a whistleblower complaint. I guess my question for you is why Diane Rourke and not other staffers? You know, why was she responsive? Why was she receptive to your concerns and others were not?
She was not the only one that was receptive, but she was the primary one, and that's probably because she had the NSA account as a professional staffer on the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence. She had the inside track. She spent a lot of time at NSA. The other critical factor, in summary, is that she was looking for the very best of NSA, both within government as well as the contractor pool, to meet the demands, the challenges that NSA clearly faced for the 21st century. One of the great issues that faced NSA, they actually called it a challenge problem, is how do you make sense of the vast streams of digital data that were increasingly streaming across the threshold from all over the place, and make sense of it. And one of the challenges NSA had, frankly, is that the structure in which they had come into existence in 1952 under a secret executive order under President Truman was dealing with the threat of communism, very monolithic, very rigid, very authoritarian structure. You're now in the internet and digital age, and there was far more information, far more data, far more knowledge that NSA had to contend with. And this was, frankly, posing a significant challenge in its ability to make any sense of it.
That leads me to a related question. There's been a couple of articles by James Bamford in Wired reporting on a new NSA data center in Utah, and basically indicating that NSA has or is on the verge of having unfettered access to all American communications, and that potentially everyone is a target of NSA surveillance. NSA Director General Alexander has denied this and said it is not true and it is not the agency's intent and so forth. I am not asking you to disclose classified information, but I would like to ask you, how should Americans assess a story like this and the agency's denial? What should we think? How should we find out what's true?
We should be skeptical of anything NSA seniors say about that center. And it's critical to pierce the veil of secrecy. And so why this multi-billion-dollar complex, which is apparently scheduled to go operational sometime in 2013, is being built there, and for what purpose?
What is the best or most appropriate way to pierce that secrecy?
Ask the hard questions.
To who should ask, and to whom?
Well, actually, all Americans should be asking. Mm-hmm. For those in the audience and beyond this room, how would you like to have the government knowing just about everything there is about you, or the possibility of being able to know everything there is about you electronically? It raises some very substantial questions, far beyond some of the post 9/11 justifications for counterterrorism. Why do you need a center that stores that much data?
Good question. Tom Drake had some rough breaks in the last few years, to put it mildly. His name was the only name on the indictment, but he was really standing in for everyone who is concerned about exposing government misconduct and the right of government employees to speak to the press and the right of the press to have access to accurate and complete information. And so we are all in his debt, and it's an honor to be on the stage with you. But although he had plenty of, as I said, rough breaks, he also had some great good fortune by making contact with Jesselyn Radack, who has been an extraordinarily persistent and powerful and effective advocate. And it is, I think I said, and if I didn't, I definitely thought as recently as April of last year that, it's a pity, but Drake is going to jail. The whole direction that this is moving in, he's going to jail and probably for a long time. One of the main reasons he didn't is Jesselyn Radack's effective advocacy. And so I would like her to tell us a little bit about that. Why isn't Tom in jail right now?
Because he told the truth and the charges were trumped up, as evidenced by the fact that all 10 felony counts were dropped and he pled guilty to a minor misdemeanor. With no jail time and no fine. I'm representing not only Tom, but the two of his colleagues who were also reported in the Wired magazine article you mentioned, and I also have the dubious distinction of representing another whistleblower indicted under the Espionage Act, again on charges that are as equally flimsy and trumped up. And I think the one thing that Tom had on his side all along was the truth. And I think while he had great defense lawyers, I think the saving grace ended up being the media and people who were willing to dig in and really investigate what this was about. And thank God we have a fourth estate in this country right now.
So if you're charged under the Espionage Act, you'll be in better shape if you can get 60 Minutes and the New Yorker to cover your story. Is that one of the lessons?
Well, yes. I think it's, any criminal defendant who is charged is going to have to remain silent, obviously, because they don't want to say anything further that could incriminate themselves or create impeachable material. Therefore, they need other people to be their voice. Unfortunately, tagging someone with the Espionage Act label alienates them from their natural allies in the civil liberties, open government, whistleblower, First Amendment communities. So,
because he wasn't charged with espionage, obviously. Nobody, not even his worst enemies, suggested that he was spying. But by charging him under the Espionage Act, you're saying there was an inevitable taint of that horrible crime associated.
That's exactly right. I mean, it's one of the worst charges that can be leveled against an American is espionage. And it definitely gives the impression that you're a traitor and a turncoat and a spy. But for some reason, there has been a recent spate of prosecutions under the Obama administration against people who are whistleblowers, not spies.
And how do you understand that? What are the politics of that, or are there politics?
Well, I think it's definitely politicized. Initially, we thought it was to curry favor with the national security and intelligence establishments, with which Obama was not seen as strong when coming into office. But later, it's become clearly more sinister as journalists have been implicated, for example, in the case of Jeffrey Sterling. And I think this is a way to lay a groundwork and bad precedent for going after journalists. And I also think, in the grand scheme of things, it's kind of a backdoor way to create an Official Secrets Act, which our country has lived without for more than 200 years.
This may be an unfair question to ask a defense attorney, but do you acknowledge the possibility of a legitimate anti-leak prosecution?
Of a legitimate anti-leak prosecution, yes. I mean, under the proper statute, sure. Under Section 1924 or under Section 798 for unauthorized disclosure of classified information. But there's a distinction between leaking, for example, in the case of Scooter Libby, which had no inherent value whatsoever, and blowing the whistle, in which an employee reasonably believes that what he or she sees evidences fraud, waste, abuse, or illegality. And whistleblowing is in the public's right to know. And I see a big difference. In fact, the way Tom became a client was I had done an article on the difference between leaking and whistleblowing.
Hmm. And what about the Bradley Manning case, if you want to opine on that? I don't think he is a client of yours. That seems to me to be a more difficult case. Tom was scrupulous about not disclosing classified information. If Bradley Manning did what he's accused of, then he did in fact disclose voluminous amounts of classified information, including battlefield intelligence that could be of use to an enemy.
In terms of Bradley Manning, we have a similar problem that we have with all of the Espionage Act prosecutions, and Manning is also charged under the Espionage Act, which we have yet to hear the United States articulate any specific harm that's been done by the leak or any benefit to a foreign nation. Clearly, the collateral murder video absolutely was whistleblowing on war crimes. A lot of the other cables, which I don't actually know a single person who's read all 250,000 of them, reveal other very problematic things. Yes, some of it's embarrassing, but with Manning, we end up having this degree. I mean, it's an argument over, not over kind, but over degree, and he leaked or disclosed too much. And I've represented another whistleblower or worked with another whistleblower who's in jail right now because he held back and disclosed too little. Mm. And I think we have to look at the actual content of these disclosures, and the government's very quick to gloss over the disclosure he made of the what's been dubbed the collateral war video. And I don't know why there haven't been more questions about why our troops in an Apache helicopter are gunning down innocent Iraqi civilian and children as if they were playing the state of war or some other video game and high-fiving each other.
Daniel Ellsberg, who's sort of the archetypal leaker, said recently that, in his opinion, his case and that of Bradley Manning were largely indistinguishable. I thought that was actually incorrect, and that they are distinguishable in several ways. In the case of the Pentagon Papers, Ellsberg, not only did he read every word, he wrote many of the words in the Pentagon Papers and knew exactly what he was releasing. In the case of Manning, again, presuming, which may not be correct, presuming that he did what he's charged with doing, not only is it unlikely that any one person read the hundreds of thousands of records, it's unlikely that Manning read them, it seems to me. And if he did, it's unlikely that he was in a position to appreciate their exact sensitivity. Ellsberg also, it's not widely known, he actually withheld 4 volumes of the Pentagon Papers, which he deemed too sensitive to release. And Manning, as far as we know, did not withhold anything. And then lastly, Ellsberg turned himself in. He said, yeah, I did it. Give me the consequences. And Manning was identified involuntarily. So it seems to me there are some difficulties associated with his case. Unless the government were to say that, well, you know, if you're disclosing it to a publisher, then that's fine. You know, we can't stop you. But if we're going to say that some information is not meant to be disclosed, then they need to take some kind of remedial action, probably some legal action.
And I can't speak for Ellsberg himself, but I think, contrary to what you said, that Manning actually did, he had access to much higher level information than that which he disclosed. Mm. And so he is like Ellsberg in that way. I think Ellsberg also sees the parallel in terms of there had not been a disclosure of such a high volume of information since he had revealed the Pentagon Papers until Bradley Manning. I think that's where he sees another parallel. Mm-hmm. And again, the focus on having the full force of the entire executive branch going after the person who's trying to reveal, in Manning's words, I think what I'm seeing is a crime. Mm. I think most people would be mortified by this. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I can live with myself if I keep this to myself. Mm. I think Ellsberg had identification there in terms of the call of conscience. Mm-hmm. So yes, there are differences, and but certainly the response of the country, I mean, with Ellsberg, it went all the way up to the president attacking him, and with Manning and Julian Assange of WikiLeaks, with there being a worldwide manhunt. Mm. And you have to wonder, you know, how our resources are being used to quiet those who are trying to release or bring about some pretty controversial information, and actually going after people who are really our enemies. Again, the government has spent, in both Tom Drake's case and in John Kiriakou's case, years-long, multi-million-dollar investigations into things that neither of them had anything to do with, but they need to bring home the proverbial scalp and show something for that, and are going after people who actually revealed two of the biggest scandals of my generation and the Bush administration, namely secret domestic surveillance and torture. And I find it appalling that the only people prosecuted in connection with those scandals are the people who blew the whistle on them. It speaks volumes about where our priorities are right now.
Yeah. Well, I want to come back to that and how that prioritization might shift in the future. But let me turn to Tim Shorrock, who's kind of the Lewis and the Clark of mapping out the world of intelligence contracting. Why don't you just talk to us, give us an idea of how the world of intelligence has changed since 9/11. Tell us about its scale and its complexity, and with a particular focus on the role of contractors. Why should we know more than we do about the role of contractors in intelligence?
Well, first of all, it's grown exponentially. Anyone who read, anyone who's been watching the national security situation since 9/11, you know how much it's grown and expanded. The Washington Post a year or so ago did a series of stories, of which the first one was very significant, where they actually mapped it out, and you could actually see, you know, the hundreds of thousands of people who have security clearances and all the different centers that have been set up and so on. And what I brought out in my book, and I got a document that Steve and I sort of shared on the internet at the time, and I wrote about it in Salon, was that actually 70%, that's 70% of the intelligence budget goes to the private sector. And that goes from everything from satellites to, you know, to pencils. But the fact is, all this money goes into the hands of private corporations that make profit from intelligence. And we're talking about the highest levels of intelligence, or we might say the worst levels of intelligence. We're talking about surveillance, warrantless surveillance. We're talking about torture. Every aspect of intelligence contractors are involved in, and in a very major way, too. They're not just peripheral. They don't just supply a little bit of technology. They help plan projects, as Tom very well knows. They're in it, at the very highest levels. These people go from their jobs in government. They go into the private sector. They go into a company like Booz Allen Hamilton or Northrop Grumman. Then they come back to the intelligence community, so-called, and they have a job in the NSA or the CIA, and then they go back again, and somehow they're supposed to keep these little slivers of knowledge that's highly classified apart from the rest of their life. But these people are, they've become a class. It's a new class of intelligence, a new class of intelligence people that we don't read about very much, because when the press covers intelligence, they talk about the intelligence community like they're all government officials, like they're not, you know, half of them aren't working for the private sector. And I think this is something for any reporters in the room, this is something you need to start doing, is start, you know, looking at this as a joint venture, basically, between government, between intelligence agencies, and between corporations, in which the corporations make a great deal of profit. This one program that Tom was indicted for passing information about, called Trailblazer. The reason Trailblazer was chosen by the NSA, from what I understand, was that they thought this could be the, you know, catch-all, like Tom was saying, catch-all the information that they needed to catch and analyze it properly. Whereas there was another program that was not contractor-run, that was protective of people's Americans' civil liberties, but they went with the bigger program, and this was a contractor-run program by a company called SAIC, which those of you in New York may have heard about this company because they recently paid a $500 million fine for fraud in this city, employment office, and $500 million is a big fine. The reason they paid the fine is because they didn't want to be blackballed by the government and not get contracts. But the fact is, 70% goes to these companies. And much of this, you know, in the past, a lot of intelligence that was, you know, acquired through contract was, you know, high-tech cameras. When they, you know, when they photographed the Soviet Union and these satellites, and then people made really amazing cameras that picked up every detail of Soviet army bases or China and so on. But you know, over the past 30 years or so, it's gone from that kind of technical support to actually analysis. A lot of these companies, all they do is provide analysts that go work for the NSA, that go work for the CIA. So you can be sitting at a desk in the NSA or any one of these agencies, and there'll be four or five people next to you who are working, who are contractors, who are working for various companies. One of the big NSA centers I know of, there's a big listening center in Georgia. I think the vast majority of the analysts that are sitting there with headphones on listening to phone calls are contractors.
Are there special challenges involved in reporting on the intelligence contractor system, or is it doable?
Well, I wrote a book about it, so it's doable. I've written, you know, a lot of articles about it. There's sort of an amusing story I have about Bob Woodward. You know, in the article that was in the New Yorker about Tom's case, she quotes one of the Justice Department lawyers for Bush, who said, you know, they shouldn't have prosecuted Tom Drake for leaking. He should have prosecuted the people that leaked all these all this information to Bob Woodward for his books about Bush's wars. And one of the things that Woodward got a hold of, and he found out about, was, you know, this sort of, he called it the greatest, you know, secret we've had since the Manhattan Project, since World War II, which is basically how they tracked and find and kill terrorists like in Iraq. And you know, when Woodward's book came out, it was like, I think it was 2008, it was about the same time my book came out. And he's on 60 Minutes and he's on CNN saying, you know, this is this amazing, you know, in technology, and it's highly secret, and the government begged me not to release any details, and I'm not going to tell you anything about it, but it's the greatest thing since, you know, the Manhattan Project. And it's how they caught these terrorists. And I'm thinking, this is interesting. I found out about this like 2 years ago when I was at a big contractor exhibition. There's this annual meeting called GEOINT, which is Geointelligence, which is, you know, the geospatial, the imagery agency that provides that kind of intelligence to the government. They have this annual conference, and I discovered that hardly any reporters went. And I was one of the very few reporters to go there. But 2 years before Woodward's book came out, I was at several briefings where people talked about how they tracked and found Al-Qaeda leaders in Iraq. It's a combination of basically the NSA technology of picking up cell phones and the NGA, the National Geospatial Intelligence Agency, having imagery, live imagery, and they combine these two kinds of intelligence, and they have on their screen, you know, a picture real time, and they follow these guys and call on the F-16s and they blow up the guy's house. But the thing is, the reason I heard about this at this, you know, exhibition was because all the entities supplying the technology are corporations, of course. It's, you know, Northrop Grumman, it's Booz Allen Hamilton, it's these hundreds of little companies all around the Washington Beltway that provide this kind of technology. So, you know, somehow I stumbled into the Manhattan Project just by wandering around these private sector conferences. And a couple of years later, Woodward was out on 60 Minutes saying this is the greatest secret he'd ever, you know, stumbled upon. So there is ways to find out
about
this.
That's actually pretty interesting, because it means that the role of contractors may function not only to increase secrecy and remove it from congressional and other oversight, but may also create openings
That's
and
right.
new avenues for disclosure that wouldn't exist otherwise. Let me move on for the moment to Jamil Jaffer. I read a book recently called Power and Constraint by Jack Goldsmith, who's a former Bush administration attorney and head of the Justice Department Office of Legal Counsel. And along the way, he writes, he describes Jamil as a hero of progressive litigation, a man at the vanguard of the national security bar, who used the courts and the FOIA, the Freedom of Information Act, in new ways to extract the government's darkest national security secrets. So that seemed like a nice formula and a nice compliment. And he also criticizes Jamil. He says that Jamil does not see the forest for the trees, meaning he doesn't realize how powerful he really is. That's also a criticism I could live with.
Yeah, I think that Jack, you know, all of this is great, and you know, in a way, the most important phrase you learn as a litigator is "I rest on my papers," and maybe I should just rest on my papers here. But Jack Goldsmith makes this argument or says these things in the service of a much larger argument, which is an argument against traditional checks and balances. Essentially, he says, stop worrying that Congress isn't paying any attention to national security policy.
Because Jamil's got it covered.
Yeah, because the ACLU, you know, has got it covered. which is ridiculous. You know, I think that at the margins, organizations like the ACLU are often effective, and occasionally we get lucky and we're effective in a more significant way. But the ACLU and the whole field of human rights organizations is not a replacement for traditional checks and balances. It's not a replacement for Congress. It's not a replacement for the courts. And so while I'm happy to take his compliments, I feel a little dirty doing so because he uses them for the wrong reasons.
Yeah. Are you winning more than you're losing, or do you feel that you're losing ground? Or to put the question another way, you know, what are the dominant trends in the areas you litigate on, surveillance and torture and detention?
I think that we're definitely losing more than we're winning. I think we're losing ground, and we're losing ground on both of those fronts. I think more and more it's becoming acceptable for the government to collect information about us, and more it's becoming acceptable for the government to deny us information about it. And those two trends, I think together, are very dangerous. And organizations like the ACLU can slow down those things, but I think that these trends are much bigger than an organization like the ACLU.
Are the trends technologically determined? In other words, is the power and ubiquity of surveillance out of our control already?
I don't think so, although, you know, maybe Tom has a different answer to this. I think that part of the problem is that the law that governs government surveillance is 30 years out of date. And that's true not just of statutory law, like
the
electronic...
Are you talking about FISA?
Well, I'm talking about the Electronic Communications Privacy Act. Oh. I'm talking about FISA, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, but also about the Fourth Amendment. The way that the Fourth Amendment has been interpreted by the courts has essentially made that part of the Constitution irrelevant to this debate. Mm. Now, there was this one great decision last term, which I'm sure we'll talk about, but leaving that to the side for the moment. Jones, right, the GPS tracking case. But until that decision, the combination of the third-party records doctrine, which essentially holds that if you give your information to somebody else, including an ISP, your information is no longer constitutionally protected. So that's one doctrine. Another is a standing doctrine that's essentially foreclosed public interest organizations from challenging government surveillance in court, because you can't challenge government surveillance unless you can show that somebody's communications were wiretapped, and the government doesn't disclose that any particular person's communications were wiretapped. So the effect is government surveillance programs are insulated from judicial review. So the combination of those two things, also the reasonable expectation of privacy doctrine, which is kind of a downward spiral because of technology, because the more we have these technologies that allow the government to gather information easily, the more reasonable it is for people to expect that that information will be gathered about them. And the consequence is that that doctrine hasn't really protected us very much at all. So I think that, you know, a big part of the problem is the law. Whether fixing the law will fix the problem, I think, is that's a hard question. I think it can certainly fix some of the problem. Mm. And you know, some people have argued that we have lost this debate, we've lost this, technology has made this debate irrelevant because the government just has so much technology at its disposal, and private actors have so much technology at their disposal, that trying to protect information from collection is a lost cause. But even if you accept that, I'm not sure that I do, there's still the question of what happens to the information once it's been collected. What are the rules on retention and dissemination and analysis? And right now, those sometimes go by the rubric of minimization policy. Right now, minimization policy is very, very weak. And it's weak because those statutes I mentioned don't require anything stronger.
I'm going to ask you a question and then ask each of the panelists to respond to the same question. And then in a few minutes, we'll open to questions from the audience if people have questions. Question I'd like to ask you, all of you really, is there a way back to the pre-9/11 national security environment? Or, you know, is the course that we are on irreversible? And more specifically, I guess I'd like to ask you, if you had the proverbial magic wand and you could change one thing or make one policy step happen, what would that be? You can answer however you like.
It's real simple. Restore the Constitution.
All right.
Fourth
Tom,
Amendment.
tell us more concretely what that means.
Look, the government at the highest levels has abjectly violated the Constitution, the rule of law. That's a fact.
More specifically, what are we talking about?
Well, in my particular case, you know, massive contract fraud, but in particular, a specific strategic decision that was made by the White House in collusion with NSA to fundamentally violate the existing statute, which was supposed to be the exclusive means by which you would conduct electronic surveillance. And you had to have a warrant to do so, although there were special circumstances in which you could start surveillance, what they call hot pursuit, under limited circumstances, you still have to get a warrant. They just chose to ignore the law, mm-hmm. right? So it's that simple to me. So if the government is willing to bypass and violate its own law, the very government is supposed to be protecting the Constitution, then you have open season on just about everything else. So if there's nothing to stop them from doing so, if there's no disincentive for them violating the Constitution, none of those who are perpetrating those violations are being brought to justice, and the only ones that apparently are those who reveal the injustice and the violations. And it's critical, really critical for the audience here and beyond, that the means by which you protect the Constitution, defend the Constitution, those means were developed. Those means were programmed. I worked on the Thin Thread program. I was the executive program manager after my colleagues left the agency. We did our best because built into that program were the very protections with the existing law that was on the books, which was FISA, which, by the way, was not old and decrepit. It had been modified 5 times since it was introduced in 1978. Why was that law introduced, which in itself was a compromise? Why? Because of massive abuse during the 60s and 70s by the U.S. government, without even FISA, just violating the Fourth and First Amendments, against Americans and U.S. citizens in this country. People that dissented against the government, people that disagreed with the government, anti-war protesters, journalists, and reporters being routinely monitored, even persistently monitored, with the technology of that day. So the idea that somehow, you know, we've crossed the Rubicon, we can't bring it back, it's simple. Now, if we have the government simply just going to go ahead and choose to violate the very Constitution that it's supposed to have to protect, then we're in a whole nother playing field.
Well, the constitutional order doesn't presume that government will not violate the law or that it will behave honestly or honorably. It presumes that if they fail to uphold the law, they will be checked and balanced. They will be brought into line.
Well, I'll comment on that in pulling out my magic wand, because it puts a gloss on what Jamil said. Not only do we need effective laws, but we need accountability and for our government to obey the law and be held accountable when it doesn't. And that does not mean Congress retroactively immunizing lawbreakers who electronically eavesdropped, and it does not mean our president deciding to look forwards, not backwards, at numerous officials who tortured. It does not mean having secret signing statements to the effect, to opposite of exactly what the law says. And it does not mean shutting down lawsuits, for example, one of the few viable lawsuits challenging warrantless wiretapping, where people did find out in Al-Haramain that they were surveilled because, oops, the government sent them the record, but then the government is asserting the state secrets privilege to shut that down. So if people would obey the law, I mean, I think that's half the battle. I mean, I feel like we're living in this lawless, selective prosecutions, state secrets privilege, secret signing statements, that all of this is part of a whole secrecy regime that started with the Bush administration and that has been expanded, unfortunately, under Obama. And yes, if I could have done the one thing, I would have impeached Bush.
Here's one example of what I call, this is the culture of corruption. One example post 9/11. This is what we're facing within our own government. When I found out about what NSA was doing under the authority of the White House, when I was told by one of the leading attorneys, Office of General Counsel, that it's all legal and that NSA was the executive agent for the program, when I found that out, I realized that if I didn't say anything, I'd be complicit and an accessory to the subversion of our own Constitution. When I raised concerns within NSA, I was told the following, right? When I say concerns, because they were saying, hey, FISA doesn't work anymore. We live in exigent conditions, Tom. You just don't understand. It's a very different world now because of 9/11. I say there's a legal means by which you change the law. You go to Congress. If the law's not working, there's a means by which you can modify and change the law. And if that's a problem, you get the Supreme Court to review it. You know what I was told? Congress will say no.
Tim, you want to take a stab?
I want to talk about two things. One is, you know, there's this climate of fear in this country. It's generated and expanded by the media. And you have all these people that go on the media all the time because they got 24 hours to fill. And when they come to a military crisis or there's some kind of crisis overseas, some kind of incident, you see this parade of people. And they're saying, you know, we got to do this, we got to do that. And it's always, you know, take stronger measures. Obama's not doing the right thing. You know, he's damaging our national security. We've got to tighten up. We've got to do more surveillance, et cetera, et cetera. You know, you see the same people. James Woolsey, who used to be the head of the CIA. Michael Hayden, who was the head of the NSA when all this illegal surveillance went on. And he himself is a contractor now. He's making money from this like they all do. But if I could wave a magic wand, I would get all these people off of the media. That's obviously, you know, there's First Amendment there. But the problem is these people do not identify themselves for who they really are. Oh, yes, he's a former CIA. What does he do? Well, he happens to own a company that makes serum to protect against bioterror. And here he is scaring the hell out of you about bioterrorism, you know, somebody coming in. That's James Woolsey for you. He makes money about everything he talks about, every single thing he warns about. He has dollars in his pocket because he has company, he has interests. And these people have financial interests. They're very, very rarely exposed on TV. There was a series of articles in the New York Times about former generals or, you know, retired military people who are working for defense contractors who were talking about the war. And this was a really good story. Got a big splash for a while. But this is a very big problem, I think, of this climate of fear. And just as an afterthought, you know, when we talk about generating terrorism, you know, it's stopping wars like the kind of wars we're fighting in Yemen, where we're dropping predators on people and killing civilians and just making people think they have no alternative but to blow up Americans. I mean, we got to stop this kind of offensive war and stop supporting dictators like we do in Yemen and places like that where people don't feel that they don't have a choice, one side or the other. But I think getting having some rules about what stricter rules about what government, high-level government people can do after they leave government is absolutely necessary. Right now, it's something like, I think it's 1 or 2 years, you cannot lobby the agency you once worked for. Well, a lot of these people don't go into the company and lobby. They go to this company, they join the board of directors, they're not a lobbyist. But what they do is they're, within the industry, they're called rainmakers. You get someone with high-level intelligence experience, like George Tenet, for example. He goes to a company like Kinetic, a British firm that's now very big in U.S. intelligence, and he helps them get contracts because he knows where the bodies are buried. He knows he knows the kind of wars we're fighting, what's going on, all the covert operations, and he knows where certain kind of technology can come in, certain kind of work can come in. And I think this is a really serious problem. Of somehow putting some controls on what these people can do after they leave government.
Okay. Jamil, you want to tell us something encouraging?
No, I actually wanted to do just the opposite. I don't know what the solution is. I have a long list of sort of specific changes that I would make if I could to things like FOIA, to the state secrets privilege, to the Glomar Doctrine, which is the doctrine that allows the government to refuse to confirm or deny that files exist. That's the doctrine that the government's relying on to refuse to confirm or deny the existence of the drone program. But I don't actually think that, you know, this panel sort of identifies secrecy as a problem, and obviously secrecy is a problem. I think that sometimes we think secrecy is more of a problem than it actually is. Mm. The drone program is an example of a situation where we use the word secrecy to describe the problem, but secrecy isn't actually the problem. We all know that there is a drone program. We know there's a targeted killing program. We know that they used it to kill American citizens last year. So it's not really a secrecy problem. Yeah. I think the problem there is a kind of disconnect between the official narrative, which doesn't recognize facts that we know to be true, and then the true narrative, which we all know. Yeah. And that's really more of an accountability problem than a secrecy problem. So I don't think secrecy is always as big a problem as we think it is. And then secrecy can also be a way of putting the burden of these policies on someone else. And I think we sometimes use secrecy in that way. So what I'm thinking of, for example, the experience we had with the torture photos, the Abu Ghraib torture photos. So some of those photos were leaked to the media. After they were leaked to the media, the ACLU litigated for the release of other photos from other detention facilities. And the government conceded at the time that there were those photos. And we won in the district court. We won in the Second Circuit. In a press conference, the Obama administration, I think it was Gibbs, said it would be hopeless for us to take this to the Supreme Court. And after that happened, President Obama promised to release the photos. But then Congress passed a bill that retroactively exempted the photos from the scope of the Freedom of Information Act. And Congress obviously is, you know, ostensibly representatives of the people. And so that was a situation where
they were working checks and balances on the ACLU.
Right. Well, it was a situation where it was a very demoralizing thing for us, because we had said for 5 years, you know, the people have a right to know, Americans have a right to know what was done under their name, and we sort of presented ourselves as the representatives of Americans. Yeah. And then the body that truly is supposed to be the representative, body came out and said, you know, we don't actually want to know. And I think that calling the problem, Thinking about the problem as a problem of secrecy, is not complicated enough. I think that it's not that simple.
Let me respond in two ways and then invite people to ask questions. I think you're right that it's easy to say secrecy, secrecy, when that's not the whole problem. Vicki Duvall, formerly on the staff of the Senate Intelligence Committee, had an op-ed in the LA Times in which she chastised Senator Leahy for saying, you know, we want a copy of the OLC opinion on drone kill. She said, sure, we'd like to see it, but we really don't need it. We know what it says. And let's move on to the policy. And, you know, asking, well, give me the document, that's an easy kind of cost-free demand to make. Let's go beyond that. So that's one point. Another thing I would say in response to you and also to what Tim said, my sort of working theory is that terrorism, the phenomenon of terrorism, has driven our political system crazy. It has scrambled all of our institutions and our and we end up talking past each other in many cases. You know, under extreme circumstances, it is sensible to violate the law. If you're taking an injured person to the hospital, you may not wait at every red light for it to turn green. You're going to say, all right, enough, I'm going through the red light, I need to get to the hospital. But if you start saying, well, every moment into the indefinite future is an emergency, then the rule of law goes out the window. And too often, we have assumed that we are in a, the needle is all the way in the red, and that we have to take an extreme response to a threat that we really don't know exactly what its magnitude is. And I think, that is that has corrupted our political process and skewed our debate so that we really have trouble grappling with real security issues. Anybody have any questions? Sir, all the way in the back. I think we're going to take a few questions at a time. Please try and phrase it as a question, and then we can take it from there.
I'll try and phrase it as a question. I want to compliment you, Steve, because you've done as much as the other people up
there. You're out of order. Go ahead.
To combat secrecy. But as some of you know, I've worked for 45 years trying to make checks and balances work in this area.
Do you want to identify yourself?
Bert Wides. I ran the Church Committee investigations as counsel of President Carter for oversight of all intelligence. Worked on the first and more recent FISA bill. And I think American history is, as I think you several said, divided between before 9/11 and after 9/11. We drafted a state secrets bill. The administration said they don't oppose it, but they don't support it, which for a liberal Democrat was the death sentence. In 73, we got an amendment that would have helped Jamil, saying that in a Freedom of Information appeal, the judge would make a de novo determination. And the conference report said they had to give due deference to the expertise, and it's been interpreted as a dead letter. But most of all, in Congress, and the state secret is essential for the courts, the State Secret Act. But in the Congress, we set up the House and Senate committees to do what you said. And in the House, there were four people who took it seriously. Three were term limited. Jan Schakowsky is the only one left who really does oversight. And I think the bottom line, which is to some extent true for all, and I'll ask my question, all congressional committees, is what Goethe said in Faust, to know is to understand. To understand is to forgive. So they get co-opted. But to try and do anything, you need the public to be upset. And I think in the case of Obama, who has really let John Brennan, he's the de facto DNI, push all of this, you have to embarrass him. How can you get the public to care more about all the things you said and the Constitution than not wanting their son blown up at a rock concert?
Right. Good question. You're mentioned, by the way, in Jesselyn's book, so you need to read it. Sir.
All of you, including last person, talk about new situation, like something dramatically new happened in American history after September 11 under Bush. But what about Second War? What about Cold War? Where all rights, what you mentioned right now, were violated under much higher level. It was not just Hiroshima, Nagasaki, Dresden, Berlin. It was same with intelligence, with spies, with somebody who was suspected as spies. And my question is, realistically speaking, would America, Soviet Union, England, would win the war against fascist Germany without such approach, or enemies what America face now, let's put Western civilization face now, is more liberal, more democratic than fascist Germany? And very small question to the lady. Government can spend millions of dollars, hire so many people as they want to chase all of you. But what somebody who found himself in situation like you described can do against? I don't know how they hire you, how they pay. I know that in small case about labor rights, you have next to zero choices to win against corporation. But to win against government, I see that something real you experience. but difficult to imagine from outside. How is that possible?
Okay. Thank you. One more, sir.
First of all, I'd like to thank you all. The information was very informative. And Mr. Drake, I'd like to thank you for your courage. And my question is directed towards you. I currently represent about 1,000 individuals in the United States who have become victims, of NSA neural manipulation. It's been going on for years, since the tenure of Michael Hayden, when I was attacked. We've made some leeway into exposing this, but it's been very small. To continue to do this without the assistance of the authorities or the government has been very difficult. My concern to you is, are you aware of the Russell Trice case and Dave Lawson's case? Dave Lawson is a colleague of ours who worked with us to try to expose some of this. His case was picked up by the FBI. They dropped his case, and it was closed in the Senate subcommittee that you mentioned also. He testified for Russell Trice. Okay, we had a contingency of us that went to the FBI offices here, headquarters in New York. Manipulation is happening to thousands of people. I provide technology support. I'm a telecommunications engineer. I work for Lockheed Martin. I provide countermeasure support and I provide counseling. We've been trying to expose this for years. We filed a report at the FBI office here in the headquarters at 46 Federal Plaza. The FBI agents pulled me aside, told me there's nothing they can do. They forwarded our complaint directly to the House of Representatives.
Okay. Okay. Let's see if we can.
A question to you, Mr. Drake, is, are you aware of, what they do, but are you in a position to divulge anything about the neurological manipulation programs at the NSA?
I have no knowledge of what you're speaking of.
Thank you. Anybody moved to speak?
Well, you had a question directed right at you.
Me. I agree with you completely that historically, during times of national security crises, in the United States, civil liberties and rights are the first to go. And we've seen the Aliens and Sedition Acts. We've seen interning Japanese and the Korematsu case during the World War. But the pendulum always swings back from these national security crises. And then we had 9/11, and it never swung back to this position of equipoise. And instead, I feel like kept swinging. And part of that is the fear-mongering that keeps going on. And it's very hard as one individual to fight against a government. I was lucky that Burt Wides and Senator Kennedy intervened in my case. I don't think that would have happened today. As a DC resident, I don't have a voting member in Congress. So that was a lucky break for me, but most whistleblowers don't have that kind of advocacy, and I don't know if I'm getting to your question fully, but.
An indefinite, undeclared war of indefinite duration with a sometimes murky enemy makes for a very dangerous environment for the country going forward. I don't want to continue to see the indefinite suspension or the increasing suspension of our fundamental civil liberties. National security for the United States of America, based on the Constitution, is centered squarely on our liberties, nothing else. This idea that somehow we're in a whole different era, that we need to suspend those to make us feel safe again, or the government is now responsible for our safety, and as the price of that safety, they have fair game on all that there is about us in terms of who we are and all of our transactions and everything else that we do as Americans in this country. I'd also point out historically, if I look at the long arc of history, some have suggested that similar to what we did to the Soviet Union during the Cold War, essentially bankrupted them, is now the equivalent of what's being done in terms of this global war on terrorism. Think of the incredible redistribution of wealth that this country is currently engaged in and has been engaged in for the past 10 years. It's quite significant on a vast scale. Far exceeds a lot of the monies that were spent even during the Cold War. For what? One of the things that's really critical to understand, and this is deeply personal for me now because of what I went through for 5 years, I've lived on the front edge of what that future looks like, and it's not pleasant. I can't imagine that most Americans would want to be surveilled electronically for years on end. I was. I can't imagine the many, many months, if not at least several years, that I was physically surveilled, having my life literally turned inside out because they were trying to find something on me that they could get me on. I wouldn't want anybody to live that. You have to remember, too, in terms of our own history, in 1786, James Madison, after the failure of the Articles of Confederation, as he's staring out of his estate mansion to the west in the Blue Ridge in Virginia, he had a fundamental question that needed to be answered. A fundamental question. How best do we govern ourselves? I don't think that the best way to govern ourselves is in secret. I don't think that the best way to govern ourselves is through a national security state that is essentially becoming increasingly beholden to nobody. That's not the way that I wish, and it's not the oath that I took. I did not take an oath to defend a national security state. I took an oath to defend the Constitution. It was a grand experiment. That experiment needs to live on, not just for us, but for the world.
Can I add one thing to
that? Yes.
Bert's question raised something for me, which I remember him talking and some others talking during Bush about possibly having another church committee that, you know, really investigated what happened with intelligence. And I want to remind people that the first, you know, if you read James Bamford's books about the NSA, the way that the corporate involvement in NSA spying came about was one of these hearings. You know, they put on the stand people from these telecom companies. And I thought one of the worst moments of our political scene happened in 2008 was when they passed that bill giving immunity to the telecom companies that were freely sharing all of our email and all of our telephone traffic with the NSA, which was completely illegal, no warrants, no nothing, and Congress voted to give them immunity, no prosecution, no investigation, no nothing. That's when I started really thinking this guy Obama is not what I thought he was, because he voted for that. And I think that, you know, Tom's talking about, you know, liberty and you know, taking an oath to the Constitution. I wish that we had lawmakers that took that seriously also, that would begin to take seriously the erosion that's happened and, you know, bring people on the stand under oath to talk about what's going on with intelligence, what's talking about with contractors, what happened with this program with Trailblazer. You know, what is the role of these contractors play? No one has ever put these people under on the stand where they would have to swear an oath and say to tell the truth. We need that kind of courage, the same kind of courage that Tom showed. We need that kind of courage in Congress.
Do you have anything to add to that?
You know, the only thing I'll add is I actually think Tim gives Congress too much credit by saying that in 2008 they immunized the telecoms that had participated in the warrantless wiretapping program. That's true. But they also expanded the warrantless wiretapping program and brought it under statutory authorization. So now there's a statute called the FISA Amendments Act that allows the government to engage in dragnet monitoring of Americans' international communications. And by dragnet, I mean it's not based on individualized suspicion. This is one big difference between this program and the one that existed under President Bush. The warrantless wiretapping program was directed at people who at least at some level were thought to have done something wrong. Now, you know, we had lots of legitimate complaints about who was making that decision and how high that bar was. But there was a bar and there was somebody making that decision. And under this new statute, there is no decision of that kind being made. Instead, the government just collects all of these communications. In theory, it could collect every single international communication, one end domestic communication. I think that the only thing stopping the NSA from doing that is capacity. And I think that this Utah facility may fill that gap.
I stand corrected. He's correct.
It's absolutely important to note in terms of Congress, what you're largely have seen over the past number of years is passing ex post facto laws that essentially make legal what was being conducted illegally before.
Right.
The telecommunication concerns had to get immunity. They were criminally liable for their conduct. So they got protection.
Part of the domestic surveillance and abuses. And I just want to know how we can kind of get together and maybe find out how we can help you guys expose this. Because we're every time we try to get it, you know, we write to our senators and other people and stuff like that, and no one seems to respond. I was just wondering if there's a way that we can kind of come as a group to work together with you guys and see if we can get this exposed, because it's been going on for decades for some people. Hmm. And, you know, we're at our wit's end because we can't get help from our local government. Hmm. Law enforcement stuff.
All right, let's take another Louis.
Louis Clark, President of the Government Accountability Project. I have a question for you, Tom. You started, as I understand, started at NSA on the day of 9/11. Can you tell us what the response to 9/11 was there in terms of their critical thinking?
Okay. When it's time for the question. Yeah, one more.
So maybe this is a question for Jesslyn and Jamil, but I understand secrecy is always a problem in the courts, but does defending a whistleblower when classified information is the topic, does that present special problems?
Okay. Well, I'll speak to that quickly, because this is unlike any defending these whistleblowers, particularly in the national security and intelligence communities, has been a real eye-opener for me, because despite all this amazing technology we've been talking about today, I feel like we're back to the dark ages, because I have clients who will not call me, who will not email with me, and we're meeting in person and paying in cash. I mean, we're back to the underground parking garages, and I'm using tactics that drug dealers use. Throwaway cell phones and meeting in person and dropsies and to try to do my job in representing my clients. And certainly there have been issues with attorney-client privilege communications being eavesdropped on or being surveilled openly during Guantanamo representations, which are not the bulk of what I've been doing. But yes, it certainly has changed the landscape of dealing with whistleblowers. But in terms of getting back to the question that was asked to Tom about what changes did you see immediately after 9/11, I think that can help explain how we got to where we are right now.
I will tell you, because that was my first day on the job, that 9/11 was taken very hard by the workforce, that we had failed the country. We had failed to keep Americans out of harm's way. However, that was not the case with much of the leadership. Leadership was really in denial. I would hear the following phrase, which I think one person in particular probably had regrets ever saying more publicly, that 9/11 was a gift to NSA, a gift. It was really an interesting bifurcation. A very secret organization, knowing they had that we were part of a systemic failure called 9/11. I will also tell you 9/11 could have been prevented. One of the things that's not well publicly known is that part of my whistleblowing involved being called as a material witness in the short months after 9/11 for two 9/11 congressional investigations, which I gave highly classified information, operational intelligence, information that NSA had never shared, or information it did not know it had that was never shared, that if it had been shared and properly acted upon, probably would have stopped 9/11 alone, separate from any other intelligence agency or department. But in those few short weeks after 9/11, I will also tell you, it wasn't just the executive branch. You had Congress literally coming to NSA with an open checkbook. How much money do you need? How big a check do you want us to write? Essentially, what happened is that even on the Trailblazer program, Hayden and company doubled down on that program. And so you saw this vast expansion of what was already largely in place before 9/11, but a vast expansion of the military-industrial surveillance congressional cybersecurity complex. And so the profit motive, which I certainly give the free enterprise system, really became a huge driving force as to how much money could we make off of this crisis. As Rahm Emanuel has so well said, and I paraphrase, you never want to let a good crisis go to waste. Trailblazer became a funding vehicle. And all kinds of contractors literally bellied up to the Trailblazer bar in order to participate in the feeding frenzy. Values and ethics were incredibly skewed. The very best of American ingenuity innovation, much had been solved prior 9/11 to deal with asymmetric threats, to deal with terrorism, to deal with all kinds of low-intensity conflict, essentially what was happening post-Cold War, were abandoned and discarded. Most all of the eggs went into the Trailblazer mouth, okay? And it was all-consuming. It was an abysmal failure. It never delivered anything. And yet many, many contractors became multimillionaires as a result of that program alone, just that one program. So you have this really a bifurcation that took place in 9/11, where 9/11 became a profit center for many, many companies aligned with the military-industrial complex, the very thing that Eisenhower warned us about during his farewell address. And so this is the real challenge this country faces. Is that really the future of governance? Is that we now have a very significant alignment, or even some would say an unholy alliance, between the government and the corporate side of America at the highest levels. And it's become institutionalized. It's normalized behavior, and Congress is largely complicit. It's become a jobs program.
We're approaching the end of our program. I think I'm going to invite each of you to say anything you might wish to say for a minute or so, and then I will speak for another 2 minutes and we'll be done. So Jamil, anything that's on your mind?
Well, yes, two things. So first, I think that you know, I have this tendency sometimes to talk about this set of problems as a set of problems that was imposed upon us. And there is a sense in which the government is responsible for this set of problems. But a lot of this we did to ourselves. You know, we allowed ourselves to be scared into this. We allowed Congress, on a whole series of issues to essentially overrule the courts on civil liberties issues. We allowed the courts, as Bert was saying earlier, to adopt this ridiculous, this ridiculously broad deference to executive national security decisions, so broad that it's almost unheard of for a court to overrule the executive's decision to withhold information from the public. Almost unheard of in the national security context. And all of these things, you know, we sort of let happen. And I said earlier that I don't have a solution to all these problems, and I don't have a solution to all these problems, but I do have, you know, a list, like I said, of I could write out 12 legislative proposals, very specific legislative proposals that really would make a difference on some of these issues, on the Freedom of Information Act, on the State Secrets Doctrine, on the Glomar Doctrine, on FISA. It doesn't take that much knowledge to be able to fix some of the problems that we've identified on this panel. But what's missing is not that knowledge. What's missing is a sense in Congress that the public actually wants these problems to be fixed. While I think that it's a useful thing to do to identify the problems as we've done tonight, I think that there's we can't wait for somebody else to fix them. Mm-hmm. If we want them fixed, we need to convey to our representatives that we actually want them fixed. And that's really where the breakdown has been, I think, over the last few years.
Thank you. That's great.
For any of you who've been to D.C., next time you go, I urge you to take a plane to Dulles and go down the Dulles Toll Road and look on your left and look on your right. Every single building is one of these companies. Blackbird Technologies, Booz Allen, you know, they line up. You can go from D.C. National Airport and do the same route near the CIA. You see the same buildings. This is what's called the shadow government, except it's not really a shadow. It's right there to see. And, you know, these contractors are responsible for, you know, I'm not talking just about intelligence, they're, you know, 60-70% of what the government is. So when these Republicans say we have to cut the size of government, well, there's a whole place, you know, a whole neighborhood across the river from Washington, D.C. that they could take a look at. But, you know, they're not going to do that because they're all in the, on the take of these corporations. And I think it's what Tom said at the last thing he said, you know, this nexus between the private sector and the government is at the highest levels of government, I'm talking about, the highest levels of the CIA, the highest levels of the NSA. We've never seen anything like this before. And I think this is an extremely dangerous situation to have, and I think years from now we're going to find out a lot more of what the implications of this. But it's that implication, that core of people who are running our secret programs, who are making money from it and go back and forth, I think that's extremely dangerous to our democracy. And I don't have much of a solution for it except keep writing about it and keep exposing it. That's all, you know, that I myself can do.
Thank you. I think one thing that we haven't talked about tonight is fear-mongering, which is sort of the other side of the secrecy coin. And pretty much with every civil liberty infringing device, conduct, airport screener, you name it, that the government comes up with, there, it always comes along with the fear-mongering of, oh, this is to stop terrorism and protect national security. And so I think people need to think twice. Unfortunately, this only really affects people when it hits them individually. So people have to go through airport body scanners and suddenly they're like, whoa, you know, I don't want everyone to be seeing everything. And no one looks behind that. The airport body scanners are brought to you by a no-bid contractor represented by the Chertoff Group, all the villains in my book. The director, or the first director of Homeland Security, teamed up with former Attorney General John Ashcroft and a cabal of other people who had been in government.
Hayden's in there, too.
And Hayden is advising Romney. You know, so there's this whole, you got to peek behind the curtain and look at the revolving door. But again, in terms of accountability and what's going on with the people I represent, who could be any of you, no one wakes up and says, I'm going to be a whistleblower today. And it is a very loaded term and one that it can be quite cringeworthy for a lot of people because in 2003, whistleblowers were people of the year and other times they are enemies of the state. And so I think we need to pass the Whistleblower Protection Enhancement Act, which has been bouncing around Congress for 12 years. I think we need to have Obama not just talk the talk, like in the transition agenda, about protecting whistleblowers, but actually protecting them, not prosecuting them. And we need you. We need not just the Government Accountability Project and the ACLU and the Federation of American, like the Federation of American Scientists, small groups to be day after day banging our heads against the wall and screaming and shouting. We need populist uproar. And I see glimmers of that with the Occupy movement, but I would like to see it on a grander scale in terms of upcoming congressional elections. I don't like having Senators Udall and Wyden having to hint that there's a program out there that if most Americans knew about, they would be scandalized by it. But that's where we are right now. Even the most powerful people in our country are afraid to talk about this stuff. Mm-hmm. So,
for me, it's quite sobering. Given what I've experienced for the past 5 years, I do fear for the future of our republic. The national security in this country has become the secret state religion. Truth is the first and continuing casualty in the empire of lies. What country do we really want to keep? That's the fundamental question. It's a fundamental question that we have to ask ourselves as Americans across this entire land. I don't want to see, as I experience in my own life and in the lives of my colleagues, I don't want to see the equivalent of a digital electronic fence surrounding all of us in which we become virtual prisoners of the state. That's the last thing I want to see. The Declaration of Independence stated those inalienable rights given to human beings: life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You really can't do that in a surveillance state. What country do we want to keep?
That is a powerful closing comment, which I'm going to spoil now with some of my own. No, seriously. I hope you don't come away from this evening disgusted or depressed or, hopeless.
Wow.
I would like you to come away from it inspired and invigorated and given to thought. Sometimes people, the question arises, well, why are you even trying to fix this hopeless problem? And the answer is, it's not hopeless. My organization, Federation of American Scientists, has been pressing for 65 years to get the size of the U.S. nuclear weapons arsenal declassified and disclosed. How can we talk about arms control if we can't talk about how many nuclear weapons we have? Well, 2 years ago, the Obama administration disclosed that amount, that information, for the first time ever. It never happened before. A decade ago, I sued the CIA under the FOIA asking for the amount of money that the intelligence community was requesting for the next fiscal year. What are you asking Congress to give you? And they said, oh, we can't tell you that, because if you knew that, then you might figure out something or something, and then terrible things would happen. Last year, the budget request for the National Intelligence Program was disclosed for the first time ever. In February of this year, the budget request for the Military Intelligence Program was disclosed for the first time ever. My point is not that everything is okay. Everything is not okay. My point, rather, is that change is possible, change is happening, and that we need to understand better how it happens, what it takes to make it work. This is a spectacular group of people here on this panel, but all of the things we are doing individually and collectively are not enough. We need you. I think Jessalyn, said those very words, and I agree. You may see things that we don't see. You may have ideas that we don't have. If you don't, you find somebody who you identify with and support them. A question like this came up at a panel a few weeks ago in Washington. Dana Priest of the Washington Post was on the panel. And her suggested solution was buy more newspapers. And the audience laughed, and she laughed. And then she said she really wasn't joking. You do need to buy more newspapers. You need to support the institution of the press so that they can do more investigative journalism. The press does still fill a vital role that is irreplaceable. It's not replaceable by blogs, which in most cases do not do original reporting. It's not replaceable by any other medium. And so we need to support the institution of the press, which is having hard times these days. It's appropriate at the end to thank the Open Society Foundation. The idea of the Open Society is not that people will be wise or law-abiding or peaceful or honest or anything. The idea of the Open Society is that when you have openness, you're going to be able to identify errors, to organize to fix them, and to correct them. The Open Society Foundation does a tremendous service in supporting all kinds of groups that are promoting those values. We, like I said, we all need to do better. We need your help. Thank you for your attention this evening, and have a good evening.